Mi gogra dot wiang melja. Gosa gani ganze jikma. My name is Mayingan. That's my Ojibwe name. I'm also called by my Indianak name. That's Jeff Meneg. I prefer Mayingan. Especially in light of what's been taking place. I will start off by asking our Creator to assist us here today. I will do that in my language, so along with me. Hey, bonjour, j'aime Nado. My English is just a cause. Should we go to Kanoga?
Version of what I'm going to be talking about today. I'm going to talk a bit about our treaties in this area, but I also want to talk about the Indian Act and how it impacts people, our people, the Anishinaabek, but also how things like this impact you, the residents of this area. And it's only going to take a couple of hours. actually, it's going to be quite condensed, but it's Cole's Notes version. And it is important for us to be able to talk about this. Jimmy Goetz to Kim for her words. For Canada. If that's all you care about, is the money.
Over the years, and they've snowballed to this point. And we have a lot of people that were in charge that are now throwing their hands up and saying they haven't had anything to do with it. And that's not true. Let's go way back. We'll go way back to 1763, when the first treaty was recognized. It was actually a proclamation. And it was a proclamation called the Royal Proclamation. And what that did was it recognized, for the first time, Aboriginal rights within this country. And it was there. And that treaty, or that proclamation, is now enshrined, and it's in the Canadian Constitution. Those Aboriginal treaty rights are protected, not only by that clause, but also by Section 35. Section 35 stated that Aboriginal treaty rights are hereby protected within the Canadian Constitution. And that's all Aboriginal people in Canada. And that those treaty rights had to be given their due respect. Your inherent rights that are passed on from generation to generation.
Jeff Meneg, it is pretty cold out here today, isn't it?
It is,
everybody's shaking. But that goes to show you how much people care about what is happening to Canada. Maybe you can say a few words about how you feel about it.
Well, I like this gathering here today because we have a mixture of non-Native and Native people that are concerned about Bill C-45 and its impact on their environment, yeah. On our environment as Canadians.
Yeah.
And that's the purpose of today, was to educate, yeah. But also to gain allies.
Yeah, yeah.
for the Idle No More movement?
Well, you know that I'm, of course, with the Council of Canadians, and the Council of Canadians, of course, is well behind what we're all trying to do. What I'm just wondering, have you ever thought about that we are might be a mirror picture of what's happening with Palestine and Israel?
There is a lot of similarity there.
We are little islands. You know the reservations are little islands.
Yes, they are.
Within a big sea of Canada, where that should not be.
No.
I mean, you know, like she said, of course we have to stop the racism, and it, hopefully it's, mm-hmm. I mean, as you can see here today, it's gone to sleep.
Mm-hmm.
So, tell me a little bit about what it feels like to be in a reservation and then going in and out, and a little bit about that history that you even had to have permits to come out.
Yeah, well, back when my grandmother was a young person, a Native person had to have permission and that changed when she became older, and then well before I was born, people were a little more free to go, come and go, but there was still a lot of that control was placed on
I mean, it's amazing. It's almost like you would be in prison. And of course, I had never had any idea about this.
Oh, no.
Most Canadians that I talked to, and of course, we're all immigrants anyway, don't know anything about this.
Up until 1968, Native people were governed by agents of the government, the Indian agents. And
that were not Native.
They were not Native, yes. And they really, what we had up until that point were token councils, because many of the decisions had to be made by, or actually mm-hmm. had to be fully approved by the Indian agent before mm-hmm. they ever became enacted within our own communities, and they're very controlled.
It's amazing. I mean, it is amazing that you did as well as a nation, so to speak,
yeah.
As you did, because, and of course, you know, they weakened all the women by taking their children away.
Yes.
My
mother, for example, my mother was 6 years old when she was taken away to residential school. Residential school.
My gosh.
And can you imagine what it's like when you have a six-year-old being pried away from her family?
Yeah, and what it does to the mother, too.
And that was a lifelong hurt. And she often talked about it. She cried about it.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's intergenerational pain, and I still...
Of course, now we share the pain.
Yes.
Because we know about it.
That's right.
You know, so I think it's an amazing... An amazing journey.
Yes. Now, the Prime Minister of Canada did apologize for residential school.
Uh-huh.
And we did have a reconciliation effort mm-hmm. across Canada. But it really didn't go that deep. It needed to go deeper, too, so every Canadian would fully understand what the impacts of those years were on our psyche.
Yeah. Now, go ahead.
That it is my belief... And I understand that Chief Spence is getting very ill.
Mm-hmm.
It's my belief that if she passes away, if she goes off into the spirit world, that things are going to get very, very dangerously.
Yeah. People are going to get very upset.
They're going to be very upset, and there's an element there that is not here right now.
Yeah.
That is not looking to reconcile.
Yeah.
And they're the ones that are going to have to dealt with, that will have to be dealt with. So the Prime Minister has a duty to be able to stop this.
Well, the problem is that it is only the Prime Minister these days. It should be the Senate. It should be the all the elected officials.
Oh, individual MPs. Our
exactly.
MP, our
exactly.
MP has been voiced.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
You don't hear anything about anything. And when we cannot afford to be idle.
We can't.
That's
we
for
cannot
sure.
be. And that means the elected officials cannot be idle no more either.
Yeah, yeah. Or we have to throw them out like Iceland did.
That's right.
you know, so maybe that'll be the way. Yeah. Maybe we can be ruled by ourselves rather than by the politicians that are in cahoots with the corporations. Yeah. Well, thank you very much, Jeff Manik. I appreciate this.
Dance, I would have been arrested and placed in jail for before 1960. When you think about how fast time goes by, that's not all that long ago that my dance was able to be danced, that our songs were able to be sang. And today we are coming together as one, all people, globally, through song and dance. That's you, everybody, standing together in solidarity. January 28th in Ottawa. It is a massive event. We have had multiple events now in Ottawa. Miigwech, Tori Kress, and all those people who have worked so hard to do that for us, to do that for all of Canada. These movements have had more than 4,000 people with no poor action, zero arrests, zero incidents. We have had, as Idle No More, well over, they can't even count how many movements we've had. But they've stated well over 60 events incident-free. Why? Because main organizers like Tori, who have mentored myself and many other people who've taken the time to build relationships on behalf of Idle No More, local community, First Nations, Indigenous people, have been going and speaking with officers, those same officers whose pensions and unions are at risk, have been going and establishing community relationships, something that all communities have been working on for a number of years. That can't even be counted. Since Idle No More movement has begun, community relationships have begun, they have formed, and they are beginning that change that we need to see as Canadians. It's giving new respect and recognition to enforcement officers for the duties that they have, that they uphold. They put their lives at risk for each and every one of us every day. They too are a part of this with Canada. And by helping us practice in the democratic process, which is a legal right, and why we are not being arrested. We're doing it peacefully, we're doing it strategically, and we are organized. The reason is we are not here to jeopardize the people, we are here to protect the people. And that is what good planning, proper community planning, is all about, the people.
So I've been doing a lot of work with my friend Linda Kitchikisik-Juden in Ottawa. She works really closely with the Ottawa police, and she ensures public safety. So all the Ottawa events have happened, and there's been no incidents, there's been no injuries, anything. It's because of the over 20-year relationship she's built with the Aboriginal community and the Ottawa police. So actually, and she's my mentor. So what we do, we work on these events, we organize things, we get these like charts together, and then we follow them to the letter. I can't show you anymore because there's private stuff on here. So our friend Azure, she's from the Kitchikisi Z-Band on the Quebec side of the Algonquin. It's her territory where we're going to do this. And she contacted us and she told us, she said, "I woke up with a very strong feeling in my heart today. It's as though my ancestors are telling me to do something, but what can I do? Then it hit me. I had a vision of thousands of jingle dress dancers dancing as one across Canada." So this is what she told us. So we said, well, let us work with that. So we've made a call out for all jingle dress dancers to join us on Parliament Hill. When all the politicians come back to work, they're going to have to face us. We're going to be there. We're going to be there with our thousands of jingle dress dancers dancing. That healing of the jingles is going to reach right into Parliament, and they're just going to have to enjoy our company.